this event always seems to be a good event to start the year. So, first, I want to take a second to introduce Mike from Annie's. Mike just wants to say a couple words here.
Good morning. First, again, I'd like to welcome you to Annie's and thank you very much for enjoying this breakfast this morning. And one of the reasons I'd like to come up here and say a couple words is because there's so many rumors that float around the island. And unfortunately, you know, I talked to one person and they said, oh yeah, Mike's moving to Pennsylvania. No, not quite yet. Or Pennsylvania. But Annie's is not closing. And basically there's a master plan here at Nears Point Marina, which I thoroughly support. And they are going to build rental condos all the way around, and eventually this building will be torn down. But there's also going to be a new structure that's going to be incorporated into the Red Eyes and Annie's Paramount Steakhouse as well. The facility will be much smaller than what this is now. This building is about 13,000 square feet. I think the new facility will be around 8,000 square feet. So there will be some changes, but there'll still be some areas for events. So hopefully we can dispel that rumor. The second thing is we'd like to announce that effective today, that anybody that comes in from 11 to 2 or from 4 to 6 will receive a 20% discount on their food, on their salad, sandwiches, or entrees. It really doesn't apply to the fried chicken special or the lobster special, but everything else it does apply to. And last but not least, I'd like to thank Commissioner Jim Moran for all his help all these years as a commissioner. And he's a great guy and a great friend. And thank you very much. I lost my train of thought on that. We're introducing our brand new menu this week. And there's some nice little changes on there. There's a couple of price reductions. Unfortunately, I can't reduce the price of prime steaks because they're through the roof. Very seldom do I ever go out shopping at Safeway or Food Lion or anything like that because there's so much available to me here. But during the course of my years of weight loss with gastric bypass surgery, when it was raining outside and I didn't want to walk, I would take the cart and I would walk up and down the aisles at Safeway. And yesterday I had the privilege of going back in there for a few minutes. And I went down to the meat department, as I always do, just to look at the junk that's in there. No offense. And I said, hamburger's $6 a pound. I said, oh my God almighty. I remember buying chickens at 25 cents a pound. And hamburger is 49 cents a pound. I just couldn't believe it because I'm so out of touch with what the consumer is paying out there. But in any case, I think you'll enjoy the new menu. We have a brand new chef that's been with us for the last 4 months, has made some significant changes in our kitchen, and I'm looking forward to a very successful and continuation of Annie's after 25 years here on the Penn Island. My wife couldn't be here this morning. She had gastric bypass surgery Wednesday, and I'm looking forward to seeing a little bit different woman. She says I've lost everything back here, so I don't know whether that's a good thing or not. But thank you very, very much, and I really appreciate everything the Chamber of Commerce does, and I really appreciate our community. I love our community. We're such a close-knit community, and I love you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. That sounds like good news. One of my favorite places to do that. So thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
All right. Next, I want to take a second and introduce some of the elected officials we have. We'll start with the Board of Ed with Reverend Arlene Taylor. She wants to stand up. So here. Thank you. Then we have Captain Kelly, the Board of Ed. Thank you. And then Annette DiMaggio with the Board of Ed. All right, then we have Ms. Sharon Harlow. Next, we have Commissioner Jim Moran. Thanks, Jim. And last, representing Senator Ben Carter, we have Kim Craddeville. Thanks, guys. Now, like I said, I'll be the...
I am so sorry. I just wanted to also announce that Annie's has taken over the exclusive catering and event management planning at the Ken Allen Yacht Club effective January 1st.
Even more good news. Thanks, Mike. All right, like I said, we'll be the outgoing chair for the chamber this year. We had a great year, and it was fun for me and rewarding for many reasons. So I'd like to take a second to introduce the new chairperson for the Chamber of Commerce, and Ms. Casey Palmer.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Eric. Thank you, Mike, for having us here at Annie's. And our first order of business is for me to have the privilege to recognize Eric for his leadership, dedication, and service to the Chamber this past year. And we have this plaque that I'm going to present to him. All right, now I have the pleasure of introducing our 2017 Chamber Board of Directors. These diverse business leaders volunteer their time and talents to help ensure that our organization stays true to our mission statement, which is to serve, represent, and be the foremost advocate to our members in such a way as to enhance the quality of life and well-being of our unique county, its residents, and its visitors through continued and orderly growth and business enterprise. Directors, please stand briefly when I call your name. First, our executive board members, Gail Roop with APG Media is our vice chair. Bill Cawley with Edward Jones is our secretary. Ralph Twilley with Shore United Bank is our treasurer. And serving as our past chairman from the Holiday Inn Express is Eric Hoffman. We also have our directors, which would be Dale Walsh from Corsica Technologies, which I don't believe that he's here today. We have Tammy Rosendale with Rosendale Realty. Judy Wink with Chesapeake Bay Environmental Center, which I don't believe she's here. We have John Ludwig with Queenstown Bank. Doug McCartan with McCartan Insurance, Suzanne Wyszynski with Anne Arundel Medical Center, Susan Vienna with Fishergate, who joins us today, Chris McGarvey with Resource One, who is unavailable today as well, but we do have Eva Stoops from Chesapeake Environmental Labs. All right, now on to our program. The Queen Anne's County Chamber of Commerce has had a long history and partnership with the Queen Anne's County public school systems. After all, the students of today will be the workforce of tomorrow. So we believe that together we can provide these children with exceptional academics, extracurricular activities, and in many cases, hands-on, on-job training to take these smart, well-rounded, and vibrant students into the next generation of the successful entrepreneurs, business leaders, and pillars of our community. And it is with this belief and excitement that I have the pleasure to introduce the Interim Superintendent, Mr. Greg Pilewski.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. First of all, I'd like to say just thank you, number one, to Linda Friday and the entire chamber of this partnership that we've had with our business community. We as a school system can't do it without strong partnerships, and this is such one great example of that. Second, I'd like to thank Mr. Jim Moran from our county commissioners and representing the great partnership that we have with our county commissioners. The support that they give each and every day to our school system is vital. I'd also like to recognize members of our Board of Education that are here. our president, our board president, Bishop Taylor, who is here, our vice president, Annette DiMaggio, that is here, board member Sharon Harlow, and board member Beverly Kelly. Please give them a round of applause. Also, there are key people in our organization that are here today, and I want to take a couple minutes before I get started about talking about the state of schools to recognize them, because they are the ones that really make it happen in an organization day in and day out. First, I'd like to recognize Ms. Janet Pauls, our assistant superintendent for curriculum and instruction. Mr. Brad Engel, who many of you know, is our supervisor of support services. Ms. Amy Hudock is our principal at Centerville Middle School. Mr. John Schreckengoss, the principal at Penn Island High School. Ms. Teresa Farnell, our principal at Centerville Elementary School. Mr. Ed Nodell, which has just joined us. He's the newest member of our team and is our community liaison and has been a wonderful addition to Queen Anne's County Public Schools. And certainly I'd like to recognize Jeff as well as Geneva that are equally a part of our team and do a wonderful job each and every day of the work that we do to help us communicate our message to the school system. So I thank them as well. So in the next couple of minutes, I'd like to share with you a story. And that story is about our public school system. And it first starts in the story of our public school system about where we live. One of the greatest things about Queen Anne's County that was said earlier today is not only is this a great place to live, this is a great place to work, this is a great place to play, but at the end of the day, this is a fabulous place to raise your children. And that foundation, which is very significant to us as a school system. Currently, we have over 7,751 students, pre-K through 12, in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. We have 14 schools. We have 1,200 employees over across our whole entire organization. We have 77 buses, so in a year's time, we travel children over 1 million miles. We're responsible for over 1.5 million square feet of facilities that we're responsible for. And with that comes over a $90 million budget to ensure that we're educating all of our children at its highest level. And that's a significant responsibility that we take very seriously to ensure that all of our children have the highest quality education, that they have the highest quality opportunities. So, I ask this question. So what is it that we do as an organization? What do we do as a school system? Well, I'll tell you what we do, and I'll tell you what we're really good at. We make learning so exciting for our youngest learners that they become global graduates that have successful careers. That's what we do. That's what we're in the business of doing. That's what we're good at, and that's what we continue to have a high expectation of doing. And so there's another actual way to look at this. As an organization, and many of you that are successful and have successful businesses really understand productivity and output divided by input. And so for us as a school system, our output is teaching and learning. That's what we do each and every day. Teaching children the knowledge and skills that they need from one level to the next level in order to have that successful career. So our output is to be able to ensure that we have all of our students that graduate not only on time, but career ready, civic ready, college ready, to be able to go on to have that successful career that they're passionate about. Because you can't teach passion. And passion is rocket fuel. And we divide that by all of the resources in the school system to educate all students. And that's why every piece of paper, every pencil, and every person in our organization is mission critical to ensure that all of our students are educated at the highest level. So how are we doing as a school system? And there are various metrics that we use, and I'm just going to go over just a few of those. But I think it's a very important that starts to tell the picture of our school system and the great successes that we've had as a school system and some of our greatest challenges that we've got to ensure to educate all students. And first, and I know some of you in the back might not be able to see this, but this slide represents our kindergarten readiness assessment that we gave a couple years ago. And across the state, we began to administer this assessment, looking at how well kindergarten students are doing, not only across the state, but here in Queen Anne's County. And the state averages, so 45% of the students entering Maryland schools are ready to do kindergarten level work. So in Queen Anne's County, 51% of our students are ready to do kindergarten level work. That's wonderful. We're over the state average. But yet, what we're noticing is that 49% of our students that enter kindergarten aren't ready to do kindergarten level work. So what we're finding is that achievement gap is beginning very early. And so whether that's in pre-K or in kindergarten, where we start to see the achievement gap, which is a primary focus of the work that we need to do to ensure that all students meet with success. So that begins to tell one story. And so, and you've probably read over the last couple of years that Maryland and the state has changed to a new accountability measure or a new assessment, which is known as QACPS. And so that really measures students' ability in mathematics and in reading. And so what this slide represents is 2 years of that assessment, so it's very new to us. We're still learning it, and across the state of administering that, this year will be the third year that we administer that. But you will notice in the slide that I highlighted in grades 5, 6 through 8 that Queen Anne's County, although it's the new assessment, ranks in the top 5 in the state of Maryland. That's a lot to be proud of. There are 24 jurisdictions in the state of Maryland. So even though it's a new assessment in those areas, we're showing some promise. However, when we start to look at grades 3 and 4, and this starts to really begin to tell our story, is that not to bore you with all of this statistics and so forth, but this is 2 years of the assessment. And I think it's very important that although it's new, that what we're seeing is some growth, certainly in middle school when it comes to language arts, and as we move into 7th grade and 8th grade. But you'll notice here in grades 3, 4, and 5 that even though after 2 years, not seeing as much growth as we would anticipate even in the beginning stages of the new assessment. So our teachers are learning, they're continuing to learn, we're continuing to learn the assessment. So we know that we've got some work to do to ensure that all students continue to exceed or accelerate. So what this graph really shows is that in the levels of 4 and 5, which is essentially what the state is determining and the national level is determining, that students are college and career ready, that they have the skills necessary in grade 3 to move on to grade 4 and so forth and progress. So though we rank relatively high in the state in some areas, we still have work to do. But the underlying story here is that, and I didn't show this in the slide, is really when you start to look at our data demographically. And that's when we start to see great disparities in our achievement gap, specifically among special education students, students of color, our Latino students, our English language learners, and our students of poverty that continue to show this achievement gap. In the area of mathematics, you'll see in grades 6 and 7 that we rank third in the state. That's a lot to be proud of, again, even as a new assessment. But what you'll also see that in areas of mathematics from grades 3 up through algebra is that we're beginning to see, even over a 2-year period, that we're starting to see areas of growth. And that tells us that we're on target or on track to continue to ensure that students are on the pathway to progress as they move through our school system. In the areas of Algebra 1 and 2, you'll see that we rank second in the state in Algebra 1 in middle school and ninth. We're about the middle of the pack, if you will. So there are areas certainly for improvement. And then you'll see over these last 2 years that we've started to make some improvement in areas which we should start to see over periods of time as we look at our metrics. So last is in the areas of English 10 and English 11. So that's been a new assessment, but you'll see that we rank 4 in the state. Again, a lot to be proud of. But in English 10, we're about the middle of the pack. So again, in the English language arts, it starts to tell us a story about where is it that we need to add greater attention to our resources to ensure that students are continuing to succeed. And again, just another comparison over the last 2 years to show areas of growth in English and writing being a new assessment. Our AP scores of 3 or better have improved drastically over the last 5 or 6 years. So the students that we have in AP that are taking our AP exams, which have increased over the last 5 years, they're scoring relatively high. That's a tremendous asset to our high school programs in our teachers. However, another piece that we need to take a look at is access. We need to make sure that we have access to all of our students that have access to rigorous courses that we know are a predictor of students going on into the world of work or into the world of higher education, that if they have a more rigorous program, they'll much more be successful. And last is our grade 12 really decision-making. This is actually self-reported data by our seniors. When our seniors leave us in Queen Anne's County, we ask them to complete a questionnaire. We've had over 525 seniors. This is a little bit of lagging data from 2015. But there's a lot to be proud of here. 80% of our students that leave our high school go on to some form of higher education. 50% of our students enroll in four-year institutions. 30% of our students enroll in two-year. And you'll see the area that is in yellow, and I know you can't see that in the back, and I think this is an area of opportunity and an area for growth for us in Queen Anne's County. And that is, we see less than 5% of the students that are going into the world of work, or if they're going into a career track from a career and technology education program. And I think in these areas is areas that we have to explore more and develop stronger partnerships with you and our business community. Whether that is looking at dual credit programs where students can take credit at the high school as well as at our community colleges. We also need to look at early college programs where there are many programs that are in this country that a child could graduate from high school, not only with a high school diploma, but with a two-year associate's degree. And that's pretty amazing today if you think about it. So there's lots of opportunities. I think there's lots of opportunities for growth and intersection, certainly with our business community. So what are some of our key priorities as a school system as we start to tell our story? And one of our primary focuses has to be student safety. And we take the safety of our students very seriously as our key priority. We have wonderful partnerships with our local law enforcement, our sheriff's office, Chief Hoffman, Chief Rhodes and Centerville PD, Lieutenant McDonald at our state police barracks that we have out in 301. Have a wonderful partnership in ensuring that all of our students are safe. We've done a lot of great professional development with our administrators this year in ensuring that our buildings, our process, and our procedures are in place. Unfortunately, you all know the world that we live in today. And there's all cases that come across this country, even this year, of school violence. And we're trying to ensure that we have the right process, procedures, and training in place to ensure the high level of safety for our students. In Queen Anne's County, as well as in the state of Maryland, as you know, in this country, is an epidemic around heroin and opioid use. And that certainly has an impact on our school system. And we've worked diligently to have strong partnerships to be able to support students and families as they look at the addiction process. This year, we've implemented our life skills curriculum, which is in grade 6. Which is to really address this and help students make better decisions and understand the consequences of their decisions and decision-making. That has been in great partnership with Dr. Ciotola and our health department and fostering that relationship and what are we doing earlier to ensure students have access to resources. We met with the Board of Education here back in November. With the health department, we've seen an increase in sexually transmitted infections, especially among our high school students, that is certainly concerning from Dr. Ciotola and the health department. So we've taken steps and measures to help students with that. But although these are factors that influence the learning environment, they're key challenges and they're key issues that we face as a school system. One of our key priorities as an organization is to eliminate the achievement gap. And I don't believe that there is any reason that in Queen Anne's County, because we can operationalize this, that it is possible to eliminate the achievement gap by the end of grade 2. Imagine what our school system would look like if every child entering third grade was on grade level, ready to succeed to do challenging work, what would that mean for middle school? What would that mean for high school? What would that mean for the world of work? I believe that we can do it. A staff believes that we can do it. And when we can do that, anything is possible. And I think our story tells us that that's an area we need to focus on. That's an area that we need to invest in, is early learning. So part of that achievement gap is really around equity, equality, diversity, and race relations. And this is a key focus for us as an organization. One of the greatest strengths of Queen Anne's County is the diversity. It's the differences that are in this room. Everyone in this room is different. That's a powerful leverage key component in any organization, any county, is to celebrate the diversity of the people that exist within. And that's our greatest power. And I think the more work that we do around equity and equality, and we've done this, and this work has really started certainly long before I got here, our multicultural group that we have, Mr. Engel is a part of that, Mr. Modell is a part of that, many members within this room are a part of that. And that is really beginning this conversation around race and diversity and understanding the differences of one another. And so as a school system, we've really focused on that and really focusing on the equitable education of all students. Every child learns differently. Every child can learn, every child can succeed. And that's a core belief. And part of that is equipping teachers with the right skills and knowledge and understanding. Teaching is a complex process. It is a challenging process. It is not easy to meet the needs of 25, 30 students on a daily basis that all come with different unique challenges and gifts. And so part of that is helping to understand each other better. And that's why we believe that that has to be a core focus for us, especially in eliminating the achievement gap. This past spring, we had gone through a curriculum management audit in the spring. And the reason that we had done that was simply because we had transitioned to a new assessment and a new set of standards. There's not anyone in the state of Maryland has not gone through that transition. And most importantly, what we've asked our teachers to do in the last 5 years has been just short of amazing. Because we've asked them to implement numerous reform efforts simultaneously all at the same time. That's a challenge for anything that you go to implement. And I salute our teachers and I salute our principals. Because when you ask anybody to make that much of a drastic change in a short period of time, it's hard to keep up. But they've done that and they've met the challenge. So with that, we asked ourselves to really take a good hard look at ourselves and say, how are we doing? How are we doing organizationally? And the curriculum audit really looks at five areas. Looks at governance, looks at leadership, looks at our curriculum, looks at the equity of how well students are moving through our organization, looks at our assessment system, and it certainly looks at our resources. And it looks at budget and finance and how well are we using our resources to our bottom line. So this summer, we launched our innovation center, our first innovation center that we ever had in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. And there are really five themes that emerged for us as a school system. Number one is organizational effectiveness, how well organized and effectiveness of the work that we do. Number two is in the area of early learning and school readiness that we talked about. Curriculum instruction and assessment, which is a core foundation of any school system, of those three pieces being pulled together. We can't do it without the leadership and developing our next level of leaders in our organization. And I think that's another great area of opportunity with our business community, matching you as business leaders with our school leaders. What can we learn from you? And what can you teach us? How can you help us get better and maybe help us look at things differently from your lens that could add to a new level of innovation and breakthrough thinking as we meet our challenges? And last is monitoring our progress and performance. So last, I'm going to close with this, and that's really about where we believe our school system's going in the future. And one of the things that our organizational effectiveness team is looking at is what we know as our 2030 initiative. And I talk about this all the time with our staff. And why, people ask, Greg, why the year 2030? That seems so far and so long from now. Well, I'll tell you what. Our pre-kindergarten students that are sitting in our classrooms right now will graduate in the year 2030. They'll be in eighth grade in the year 2026. They'll be in third grade in the year 2021. If there's not a sense of urgency to close the achievement gap by the end of grade two, that's why our pre-kindergarten students right now are they're an indicator for us and monitoring how well they're doing, because we know that's the future of Queen Anne's County Public Schools. And we have to keep a close eye on that in order to move forward. And that's known as our 2030 initiative. I talked briefly about the importance of early learning and school readiness and the ability that we have to close the achievement gap quickly, which is known as our Get Ready initiative. And what I like about this slide, and you can't see it in the back, it's really about cradle to career. So how can we ensure that we know if we eliminate that achievement gap earlier and put more students on the right path, they have a better trajectory, a better pathway to their passion and their future, which is what they want. And it's what we want for them. So a lot of our work and our initiative is really looking at pre-K, kindergarten, grade one, and grade two, so that we can look at how our students are doing and how we're using our resources. Our next initiative is really what we've dubbed as our one-stop initiative. We've had a great investment and infusion in technology, our one-to-one initiative. Now I'm proud to say we are grades 3 through 12. It has changed the landscape of how teachers are teaching and how students are learning. But it's a tool. It's an instructional tool. And that's why it's important of how we leverage that technology to help students. And one of the things in the future is really about moving towards a learning management system. And that is simply for our teachers and for our employees, they have to maneuver multiple different platforms. We want to consolidate that into one and to be able to really connect that technology of really catapulting our innovation when it comes to students and leveraging that technology in our classrooms. Last, as I mentioned, really is our Lead Learning Grow 2.0 initiative. And we would love to pick your brain about this and help us develop us and connect with us as your leadership with our leadership to see how we can continue to grow. But you can't run an organization, you can't continue to thrive, you can't continue to innovate if you don't invest in your leaders. And to continue to invest in them and believe in them in their next level. And you know as well as I do how important training is. We have to reimagine professional development. We have to reimagine training for teachers and principals and our employees. And I know you have great ideas of what you do within your own organizations. I think that's another area to certainly partner. And our last is our on-track initiative, and that is really about how we're assessing students. In this country, it's no surprise that we're over-assessing students. And so one of the things that we have to take a look at is how much we're assessing and how we're going to make some changes in this one measure and how we look at multiple measures to determine how well students are doing in our organization. Because you can't put all your eggs in one basket. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to have this opportunity for just a few minutes to share just a small snapshot of the great success and the great things that happen every single day in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. I'm honored to be the interim superintendent. I'm honored to have the opportunity to lead and to work with such a talented group of people. And I thank you for this opportunity today to engage with you about a little bit about Queen Anne's County Public Schools. At this time, I'll be happy to take a couple questions, engage in any kind of conversation, something that we've gone over, any questions that you have. Yes?
I'm just curious, is there a way to start investing in the pre-learning before they get to school, that Judy Center, that, you know, so that by the time they're four, so they're getting some educational assistance?
That's a great point. So our Judy Center, which we have, that's up in the Sellersville area, which is another stopgap really to help students and parents really to be able to bridge that gap. And I think that is one example that we need to look at and possibly being able to replicate that. We have a whole team that's beginning to work on this, and they're even going a step further. They're thinking about how in the world do we connect with pediatricians? How do we connect with mothers that as soon as their child is born that we can help begin to support them in the importance of reading and the importance of learning? So we certainly welcome any kind of feedback or partnership, but that's something that we need to continue to take a look at that's been successful. Great question. Yes?
Do you At what point are foreign languages infused into the curriculum?
In my opinion, not early enough. We have an indicator right now, and I think I'll just take a sidestep to a second, and that is the importance of being a global graduate. You know today that across around the world that students are graduating often being bilingual or even in some cases trilingual. There are students in the United States right now graduating in some cases being trilingual. We first start a language program in middle school that students get exposed to that. They're able to take a level one in eighth grade. And that's a key thing that we've started to think about is how could we start a language program even earlier, an immersion program, that there are some immersion programs out there that are just amazing, so that we can graduate students. You know, the other side of that is starting early. You got to have that continuum program. So that's a great point. That's something that I think that we're going to look into. That's certainly a resource allocation, how we would do that. But it's vitally important to the success of our children. Yes.
Could you talk to us a little bit about where we are with technology in terms of how it's integrated in our systems, how frequently it's updated, and where we stand as far as the other counties?
Sure. I would say that Queen Anne's County is on the cutting edge with its technology. We are currently one-to-one, so we have a device in the hands of every child from grades 3 to 12. We've infused that over the last several years. We started in middle school, we moved to high school, and then now in the elementary school. So what has happened is that it's really started to change the conversation with teachers, with students, about their learning. So what you'll notice if you walk into any of our classrooms is you'll see a wide variety of technology being integrated, whether that's in a one-to-one environment, whether that's the teacher using a smart board. But what you'll also see, and this is probably a little bit of a misconception that I've heard, is that children are on the computer every day, all day, in classrooms. That's not true. What you'll see in our classrooms is really a blended environment, where as it's appropriate, it is being used with students, but you'll still see students using textbooks, using different materials. So I would say in Queen Anne's County, among our surrounding counties, we are probably at one of the forefronts of being one-to-one from grades 3 to 12. You're welcome. Are there any other questions? Yes?
I'm a newbie over here. I'm from Prince George's County. Over there, Prince George's and even more so Montgomery County, has done a lot with, and you sort of touched on, with working with more in high school grade, I guess, in internships with businesses.
Yes.
And also structuring their curriculum based on businesses that have to have a trained workforce and attracting more companies.
Yes.
To the counties. Yes. They realize that they've got to have that trained workforce in place.
Yes.
And so are you working?
We are. We can always do more. We do have internship programs. As a matter of fact, one of Governor Hogan's initiatives is called a Pathway to Technology, a PTEC high school that we're in the process of trying to implement. And part of that is exactly to do that. So it's a pathway for students that as they go through high school, and we have to match with business partners that have a specific need. And so that pathway that leads to internships in the summer, work-based learning programs, and at the end of the day, that leads to a job at the end of 2 years and an employee that is kind of tailored to that business. But that's something I think we need to engage in more. And certainly the needs, I was just with a couple business owners about a month ago, and they were talking about the misconception that a lot of people think that on the Eastern Shore there's no jobs. And about how do we connect that? How do we reframe that? And how do we meet their individual needs? Gentlemen were certainly in the construction field and talking about the high needs that they have, and that it's not just walking into an entry level, but they have pathways that lead to higher levels within their organization. So we're doing some great things with our business partners, but we can always do more.
Actually, I reached out to the school, and that's for several years I've always hired high school kids and have followed them through high school and then they come back and they work for us when they're in college. And some of them we have hired until they found their specific niche. So I encourage people to call the school system because they do have kids that do want to work, especially the seniors.
And that is such a great point. And I think one of the other things that makes us so unique as a county is that people that grew up here want to come back. You know, we look at our new teachers, half of them are graduates of our school system. And they want to come back. They want to live here. They want to play here. They want to raise their kids here. That is an asset. And we want to continue to foster that. It doesn't have to be in the field of education. It can be in any field. Those opportunities that are there. And I think that's one of the unique things that makes Queen Anne's County special. Are there any other questions? Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Greg, very much. All right. Get back to my notes here. We are going to move on to our 50-50 drawing, so if you wouldn't mind taking out your ticket for today. We are drawing $85 is what our pot is worth. And the last four numbers, 6, 7, 9, 5. All right. Congratulations, Bob Dawson. Bob Dawson, sorry. Before we conclude today's presentation, I did want to take a moment. The 2017 Directory and Resource Guide has come out. Some of you grabbed one this morning on your way in. If you did not, please make sure that you take one or two or however many copies you need for your office. I'd also like to recognize Susan Vienna from Fishergate, who is the one who did the layout and design of this directory this year. It's fantastic. Thank you, Susan. I would also like to invite you to visit our new website. It's www.QACChamber.com. We just recently launched that website last week. You should have received an email about it. It is fantastic. It is user-friendly. There's opportunities for you to input your information custom to your business, run specials, help wanted ads, lots of opportunities there. So I encourage you to go online and take a look at that. And I also would like to thank again Susan Vienna from Fishergate and Dale Walls from Corsican Technology. They were instrumental in working with our chamber staff and getting that up and running. So thank you guys for your help with that. Our next mixer, I'm very excited to announce, will be on Thursday, February 16th. Of course, we usually are every third Thursday of the month. So February 16th will be our evening mixer. And this month, or this coming month, it's going to be at Blackwater Distilling in Stevensville. So I would encourage you to come, bring a guest, and we would love to have you. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for coming today. This concludes our presentation. We look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you.